Now we need to consider the boundary conditions on the cylinder. There's two physical principles that we need to use. The first is called no penetration. The no penetration principle means that the fluid cannot flow into the cylinder or flow out of the cylinder. That means that the radial velocity of the fluid has to be zero. And if we translate that into the stream function, it means the partial derivative of the stream function with respect to theta has to equal zero. The second physical principle is called the no slip condition. For no slip, it means that the cylinder has some friction associated with it. So if the fluid is touching the cylinder, it can't be moving along the direction of the cylinder. That translates into u in the theta direction has to be zero, which for the stream function, it means the partial of the stream function with respect to r has to be equal to zero. Okay, so no penetration and no slip. What does that mean in terms of the stream function on our grid? We have the stream function at the first grid point in the Kasai direction, which is on the cylinder. What is that value? Well, we know that the stream function is independent of theta. The cylinder is at a fixed radius and the boundary is prescribed by moving theta. So the fact that psi is independent of theta means that the stream function is a constant on the cylinder. And we know that the stream function value at the midline is zero. So the value of the stream function on the cylinder also has to be zero. So psi 1j, so for all angles, have to be zero on the cylinder. The second condition, that the normal derivative of psi equals zero, would mean that the normal derivative, whether you use r or our modified coordinate cosi, doesn't make any difference, that also has to be zero. So the second condition is that the partial derivative of psi, instead of r now I'll use our modified coordinate cosi, at the 1j grid point also has to be zero. So now we have a boundary condition on psi on the cylinder and a boundary condition on the normal derivative of psi. What we really need is a boundary condition on psi and a boundary condition on the vorticity on the cylinder. So in order to get the boundary condition for the vorticity, we need to first write down the equation for psi that relates it to the vorticity. So that equation is that the vorticity is equal to the negative of e to the minus 2 cosi times the second derivative of the stream function with respect to cosi plus the second derivative of the stream function with respect to theta. But we can simplify this on the cylinder. This equation is valid everywhere in the domain. But on the cylinder, cosi is equal to zero. So this exponential is one. The stream function is independent of theta. So this second derivative is zero. So then this reduces to negative d squared psi d cosi squared. And that's true on the cylinder. Okay? So it relates the vorticity to the stream function. Now, the problem here is that it relates the vorticity to the second derivative of the stream function, but our boundary condition is on the first derivative of the stream function. So in order to convert this derivative, this boundary condition on the first derivative to a boundary condition on the vorticity, we need to make use of the Taylor series expansion. So we need to do now two Taylor series expansions. Let me show you how that works out. The first Taylor series expansion will be Taylor series expanding the stream function one grid point away from the cylinder, so 2, j. With Taylor series expanding the stream function one point away from the cylinder around its value on the cylinder. So the constant term here will be the value on the cylinder. The next term, we're one grid point away, so it's a grid spacing h. And then we have the derivative of psi with respect to cosi evaluated on the cylinder. The next term in the Taylor series expansion is h squared over 2 factorial, or 2, times the second derivative of psi on the cylinder. And because we want to derive our boundary conditions that are accurate to second order, we need to keep going in this expansion to the third power of h. So we have h cubed over 3 factorial, which is 6, and then we have the third derivative of psi with respect to cosi cubed on the cylinder. And the final, the error term here, which I'll carry, so you see that we actually are getting to second order, is big O of h to the fourth. So that means we're dropping terms of order h to the fourth and higher. So that's the Taylor series expansion of psi one grid point away from the cylinder. We're going to also need the Taylor series expansion of psi 2 grid points away from the cylinder. That will be psi sub 3, j. So again, we're expanding about this value on the cylinder. Now we're 2 grid points away, so h becomes 2h. And then we have the partial of psi with respect to cosi on the cylinder. H becomes 2h, so this becomes 2h squared, which is 4h squared, divided by 2 is a 2h squared. So we have a 2h squared, the second derivative of psi with respect to cosi on the cylinder. And now we have 2h cubed, which becomes 8h cubed. So this term I'll write as 8h cubed over 6 times the cubic, the third derivative of psi on the cylinder. And the error term here is still of big O h to the fourth. Okay. These are our Taylor series expansions. Now we want to make use of the boundary conditions. So the value of psi on the cylinder is 0. So these terms are 0. The first derivative, the first normal derivative of psi on the cylinder is also 0. So this term is also 0. Okay? And then the second derivative here, the negative of the second derivative is omega, which tells us that this term here, the second derivative then, is the negative of omega. So this term here becomes negative omega on the cylinder, so that's 1, j. And this term then is negative omega 1, j. So we're making use of the value of omega on the cylinder here. And then this is the h cubed term, okay? So let me write this so we can see how this works then. So we have psi 2, j, 0, 0. So this is equal to h squared over 2, negative omega 1, j, plus this term, which we don't know, h cubed over 6, the third derivative of psi with respect to cosi, at 1 comma j, plus the error term, plus big O h to the fourth. Okay, so this first Taylor series expansion reduces to this. The second Taylor series expansion, two grid points away from the cylinder, reduces to here, so we have now a negative 2h squared, negative 2h squared, omega 1 comma j. And this h cubed term now is 8h cubed over 6 times the third derivative at 1 comma j, plus our error, which is h to the fourth. Okay, now we're in a good position. Our good position is we want to solve for the vorticity on the cylinder, but we want to eliminate this h cubed error term to get a second order method. So to do that, we need to multiply, to eliminate this term, we multiply the first term, first equation by 8, and then we subtract the second equation. Right? So when we do that, we get 8 times psi 2 comma j minus psi of 3 comma j. So we have 8 divided by 2 is 4, so that's negative 4, and then minus minus 2, so negative 4 plus 2 gives us a negative 2, so that's going to be equal to negative 2h squared omega 1 comma j, and then this cubic term in h cancels, that's the whole point, and the remainder then is going to be terms starting with h to the fourth, okay? Now, what we do then is we solve for the vorticity. So our final result then will be omega, I'll write it in blue, omega 1j. So we divide through by minus 2h squared, so we can use the minus sign to change the order here. So we have psi 3 comma j minus 8 psi 2 comma j divided by 2h squared. And then because we divided through by h squared, the error term here is h squared. So that gives us our second order method. Okay, that's the boundary condition we want on the vorticity. So we have a zero boundary condition on the stream function. And we have a boundary condition on the vorticity that now depends on the value of the stream function, one grid point and two grid points away from the cylinder. I think this is the most complicated mathematics in this course. And it's also extremely crucial for the numerical method. So it gives us a source of vorticity due to the interaction of the flow field with the cylinder. So let me summarize. To determine the cylinder boundary condition, we use two physical principles, no penetration condition and the no slip condition. That gives us a boundary condition on the stream function and on the normal derivative of the stream function. Unfortunately, we need a boundary condition on the vorticity. So we work a double Taylor series expansion, one grid point away from the cylinder, two grid points away from the cylinder, and then use the stream function equation to replace the second derivative of the stream function with the vorticity. And that gives us then appropriate equation for the vorticity on the cylinder and the vorticity boundary condition. I'm Jeff Chasnov. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.